So, it's my great pleasure to introduce our speaker today, who is from University of Brussels, and his next speaker is Jeffrey Janssens, and he is going to speak about amalgam decomposition of high modular groups and something else.
The elementary part.
Yeah.
Hi, everyone. So thanks, Pavel, for the invitation. So I will speak about some joint work with Andreas Bechel, Eric Jespers, and Kiefer and Dorian Temmerman. Hopefully, another time I will be able to give such a talk from Brazil on. So as a PhD student, Eric Jespers, my supervisor, told me quite a lot of stories of all his mathematical travels to Brazil since the 80s and 90s. It always sounds very nice, so I hope also wants to be able to tell such a story. But for now, I will tell you about my joint work. So the goal will be to speak about what they call higher modular groups, which are discrete subgroups of what they again call Varlan groups. So I will start by introducing these. So these are higher dimensional versions of groups like SL2 over the integers of SL2 over the ring of integers in a quadratic number field, so of Bianchi groups. And if at the end, and so once I have introduced them, I will explain some methods of ours to find amalgamated decompositions of these groups. And I hope at the end to actually then explain what was our motivation to look at all this. And our motivation comes actually from representation theory of finite groups. But I will first start with the geometry. Okay, so I will recall first what was, is a Kleinian group or a Fuchsian group? Okay, so these are certain type of groups that act on low dimensional hyperbolic spaces. So I'm not planning to recall all the geometry because the goal of this talk will be rather an algebraic counterpart of these objects, but let me nevertheless quickly recall the upper half space model of a hyperbolic n space, which I denote by Hn. So we can view them as simply being all tuples in the n-dimensional Euclidean space, where the n, but the upper half plane of it, so the nth coefficient must be positive. But what is very special, of course, in hyperbolic case setting is a metric, which is given as following. So actually, we will never be doing true computations with this metric, and neither we will actually do computations with the hyperbolic model as such. But I will explain this afterwards. So this is hyperbolic space. And so the balls still are induced from the Euclidean norm, but in a bit different way. So if we look at the low dimensions, what happens there? So for example, if you first look at dimension 2, well, then the hyperbolic plane, we can also represent the elements in another way. We can namely look them as living inside the complex plane. So we see them as living in a complex plane. And the type of group that we're interested in the orientation preserving isometries of the plane. And the orientation preserving isometries will actually come from very well-known groups. And they come actually from simply PSL2 over the real numbers. So how is this action of SL2 on the hyperbolic plane defined? They are defined via what I call Möbius transformations. So explicitly, if I take some 2x2 matrix, then The action on a point of the hyperbolic plane is simply given as following. And vertice right hand side needs to be interpreted inside the complex numbers. Okay, so this can be done, and with this action we can prove that this action is actually faithful and that this action actually preserves the orientation, and it is really also preserving the metric, and actually that they all are of this form. So the orientation preserving isometries of the hyperbolic plane are the full PSL2 over the reals. So all this is quite classical. And with, so this is for dimension two. If we go to at the hyperbolic space of dimension three, well, there again, one of these tend to represent the elements in another way, namely to tend to represent them as quaternions. So we see them as following. So we see them as living inside the classical quaternions. And again, one could then look at the orientation preserving isometries, and this time they will correspond with PSL2 over the complexes. And how again is this action given? Basically, again, fully in the same way. So it's again by Möbius transformations. And if I would have to write down explicitly the action is exactly the same, but this time we don't need to interpret this expression inside the complexes, but we need to compute this inside the quaternions. So I really want to emphasize this, that this is really the same as simply interpreted in another ring, because for the higher dimensional generalization afterwards, we will play further on that. So the same, but the right-hand side inside the quaternions. And the classical quaternions I will simply denote by H. Okay, so this is a low dimensional versions. And usually, and we will be interested not in the full isometries, but in certain discrete subgroups of these. So PSL2R and PSL2 over the complexes inherit get a topology from the Euclidean space, from the Euclidean four-dimensional thing. The complex, the PSL2C get also a topology from a power of the complexes. And any subgroup which are discrete with respect to that topology are the objects of interest. And in the case of the two-dimensional hyperbolic space, such discrete subgroups are called Fuchsion. And in the case of the complexes, they are called Kleinian. Okay. So these are the type of objects which are already have been investigated since very, very long. And they are actually very nice because, yeah, basically these discrete subgroups, these Kleinian subgroups, are the type of objects that we need to consider to understand hyperbolic manifolds. So the hyperbolic tree manifolds, or rather complete ones. They all come from Kleinian groups. By simply taking the orbit space, or letting So from below to higher, we get a hyperbolic tree manifold from a Kleinian group by simply looking at the quotient space. Okay, so there is this very nice correspondence between geometry and these groups. And this geometric action has been used already since the time of Poincaré to find presentations of these groups gamma, but not only presentations, they have, in the meantime also we have been used to find decompositions such as amalgam decompositions, H&N decompositions, or a bit to understand whatever you want somehow about these groups. They usually really go from this, starting with the Poincaré polyhedron theorem of Poincaré. So simply to record a very the explicit examples that are of interest for later on. So the in the case of the Fuchsian groups, we will be interested in the case of simply PSL2Z. So of course, PSL2Z, the induced topology will be discrete, or in other words, its action on the hyperbolic plane will actually be what they call discontinuous. And the PSL2Z, and I simply mention it for the terminology afterwards, is called also the modular group. Other examples that we will be interested in afterwards is the case of PSL2 over the ring of integers in an imaginary quadratic extension. So an imaginary quadratic extension, these are examples of Kleinian groups. And another third type of example, which is quite different, but also of interest for us, is the elements of norm one in a division or in a quaternion division algebra. So these are quaternion algebras. I will tell more about them very soon. The quaternions have some norm. You can look at elements which have norm one for this. And this is the group SL1. For those people who are more used to work with what they call the reduced norms, these are simply also the elements of reduced norm one. Okay. So the quaternions, if we would view them over the complexes, then they are nothing else actually as 2x2 matrices of the complexes. So in more generally, the quaternion algebras have a faithful embedding in 2x2 matrices over the complexes. And this embedding respects the norm or the determinant. So elements of norm one would be mapped inside this embedding in 2x2 matrices on matrices of determinants one. So one can view this as a subgroup of PSL2Z. And if we do it via this typical faithful embedding, then actually this will really become a discrete subgroup. And so this will again be examples all of Kleinian groups. Okay. So these are quite important examples for afterwards. Okay. So how do we want to generalize to further? One could go in two directions. On one hand, one could go simply to, let's look at higher dimensional hyperbolic spaces and at the orientation preserving isometries of this higher hyperbolic space. And this is what we today will do. And this will yield these groups, which are called the Wahlen groups. But there is also actually another direction, but I will not tell much about it, which is looking at isometries, not of an higher, but simply more copies of H2 and H3. So a certain number of copies of H2, a certain number of copies of H3. Let's say R copies of this. Then such a direct product, I will denote it by HRS. So why would this actually also be of interest for us later on? I will simply give one example, but besides, I will only come back to them fully at the end of the talk, if the time permits. So what is a typical example where we need several copies of a hyperbolic space is when we are interested in understanding not simply division algebras or, for example, quaternion algebras over Q or over the integers, but also over larger number fields. So from the moment on that you have a division algebra over a larger number field, usually one hyperbolic space doesn't suffice. And more precisely, a bit easier even to start with, if I would denote by this time RD, not the ring of integers in a quadratic imaginary extension, but a quadratic real extension. So ring of integers in Q square root D, so not minus this. And if I would then again look at the PSL2 of this ring of integers, then, okay, this is of course a subgroup of PSL2 R, but this will not be a discrete subgroup. So in particular, these are not examples of Fuchsian groups. So if you want to use the geometry, you need to do a little bit more of work. And actually, due to the fact that it's a quadratic real extension, it has two real embeddings. So it has two real places. And using this, one can actually embed it inside two copies of PSL2R. And we can embed it in such a way using so the different embeddings of Q square root D in the reals in such a way that it becomes actually a discrete subgroup. So this is our first example there that if you want to use a geometry that we can use a direct copy of several hyperbolic planes. Here we would need 2 times H2. And so the other example of interest is of the same nature, so of the SL1 of a hyperbolic of a quaternion algebra, so where k is any number field, and in that case again every quaternion algebra has an embedding inside the 2x2 matrices, but in general, for a general number field, this will not give a discrete subgroup. And this will again depend on the arithmetic properties of the field, of the number field. And actually, it is R and S that we need to really again embed it in a direct product, but in such a way that embedding is discrete. The R will be the S will be the number of complex embeddings of K, and R will be the number of real places which are non-ramified. But okay, I will not use all this, so I simply mention it. But so these are still very natural examples where actually one would like to understand this. And I would like simply to mention at this side, to finish this side, is that so all the geometric methods that I mentioned to find presentations and amalgamated decompositions of Bianchi groups and Kleinian groups in general via the Poincaré polyhedron theorem, some of them have already been generalized by Angel Del Rio and Kiefer and Eric Jespers in the case of two copies of the hyperbolic plane. Okay, But let's go to the higher dimensional version, which is the full topic of this talk, to the phalanx. Oops. Okay. So if we go back for 1 second to the way that I introduced the Fuchsian and Kleinian groups. So what did we notice? Okay. So the hyperbolic plane, we saw it as leaving it in a complexes, and we had SL2R acting. The hyperbolic space, we saw it as quaternions, and we had the complexes acting. So somehow one could hope what would be the next step, for example, for H5. So we saw we first have the reals, then we have the complexes, then we have the quaternions. So one could then hope that the next step would be that, for example, PSL2 over the quaternions actually somehow again nicely act on the hyperbolic space, but this time of dimension 5. In such a way that the PSL2 again forms all the orientation preserving isometries of the hyperbolic space of dimension 5. So one could hope this if this simply looking at the examples would work more fully, and this actually is the case. So what are the this works, but what are the underlying reasons for this? There is two of them. First of all, the reals, the complexes, and the quaternions are the smallest examples of what I call real Clifford algebra. And for the rest, what is also quite important in these examples is that these are division algebras over R. Okay, the second thing, we already feel that this will be an quite an issue if you want to generalize further this nice picture, since that we know that the Kelly-Dixon constructions tell us that there will be no higher division algebras over the reals. Nevertheless, something can be done, and this will yield these Phalanx groups. So let me first define what are the Clifford algebras. So more generally, let's consider some commutative free. And for me, a commutative free always means unital and also associative. Then the Clifford algebra of dimension, the nth Clifford algebra over this commutative ring is an R algebra generated by a certain number of symbols. The first symbol, this will be the unit, but then also n minus one other symbols. And we say that they need to satisfy relations which looks like in the case of the quaternions. So this is an R algebra generated by these symbols with these relations. And this algebra, R algebra, is called the Clifford algebra over R. Okay, so if you look at the smallest examples, so then for example, in dimension, the first one would actually only be the identity element. So if I now doesn't simply look any, but see over the reals. So the first one would again give the reals. The second one, of course, are the complex numbers, and the third one give the quaternions. Okay. Okay, so that's not the quaternions of order reals. Okay, so maybe then with this at hand we can go further, but first a small remark is that the dimension, yeah, okay. So these are still algebras. So if I consider not any ring, but if I would consider the reals like this, and if then I would get also something which is finite dimension over the reals, and the dimension in general is 2 to the n minus 1, simply for one thing for later on. And another one, so in the case of the reals, so this in particular lives in some power, in some Euclidean space, and hence it can also get some Euclidean norm from there. Okay. Okay, but now let's go come back to this phenomena and our wish to generalize these Kleinian groups. So we have our hyperbolic space of dimension n plus one, and we take some point in it. And this time we view it as living in this Clifford algebra of one dimension higher. So that's also what we did in dimension 2 and 3. And so we see a point then in terms of this basis. And what we then would like to do, if everything would work in a similar way as in lower dimension, then we would like again to simply write down, let it act via Möbius transformations in the same way as we did before. And we would then hope that this again would work. And so where this is any two invertible matrix, let's say with entries in the end Clifford algebra. So if we do this, we actually get, however, as we could also a bit expect, it is a bit too naive and we get into troubles. And there is already two questions that one could directly ask when trying to write down this definition is, first of all, why does actually this inverse that I wrote there needs to exist? As I said, except for n equal to 1, 2, or 3, this Clifford algebra will not be a diffusion algebra. So not all elements will be invertible, so this doesn't always make sense. So the answer is, in general, this doesn't work. And another issue is, why is this expression? Because this still needs to be an action of the hyperbolic space. So why is this again in this? Also, this, of course, doesn't need to be in general the case. So what the Wallen groups will do is this will be exactly that subgroup of GL2 over the Clifford algebra such that this actually works. So I will now, so this is of course very hand wavy, and I will now write the exact definition down. But somehow the exact definition is not very enlightening, unfortunately. So concretely. So for this, I need to introduce some notation. So first I define I take the elements which are simply linear combinations of the basis elements. So as a small remark, so in the case of the complexes, the reals and the quaternions, these bases, these symbols I, they actually form a group. So they are multiplicatively close, but in general for the higher Clifford algebras, this doesn't need to be the case. And so in general, this will be truly something smaller as a full Clifford algebra. Okay, but they, what is quite important is that all these elements are actually invertible. And we want to take as much invertible elements as possible to actually make this first thing work out. So this is a gamma and R. These are all the products of non-zero elements inside this. And so this is then a subgroup of the invertible elements in Clifford algebra. So again, the typical example, if n is equal to 1, 2, or 3, then this actually coincides with all the non-zero elements. Since that in these cases, we simply had this division algebras. Okay, but in general, this is again, something which is much smaller. And we actually only want to look at matrices whose entries live inside this. So the third group that Valen defined and which was later on rediscovered by Alfors, and it's also Alfors which popularized these objects, is the group GL over this gamma and R, which are all the 2x2 matrices then with entries, not any Clifford algebra elements, but living inside this invertible type of elements or union zero, satisfying certain type of conditions. A first type of condition is the determinant needs to be non-zero. And a non-zero determinant, I will not define it, but the Clifford algebra, as the complexes have this complex conjugation, as the quaternions have this also type of quaternionic conjugation, it also has some involution, and this involution I denote by star. And we can then define that way a similar type of determinant, and the determinant needs to be non-zero, and then some other relations. And these other relations are for me not intuitive, but I will write them down. All these elements must be inside this. So this is the group GL, and then one can also define as kind of SL, which are then all those that this determinant type of thing will be one. Okay. So this group is called to this inventor Valen. So these are actually very specific groups. So in 2016, these groups have actually been defined much more generally by McInroy. So in 2016, he defined them really over any commutative ring and also including some information on some quadratic form. But I will not go into that. But okay, so still the construction is a bit simply answers this, and one can then prove that with this type of matrices, that the same action by Möbius transformations will actually work. So this will always be invertible, and this expression will again be in the hyperbolic space. And in this way, we actually, that's what Alfors then proved, is that we really get all orientation preserving transformations again. Okay, so this is really, in from that point of view, the right higher dimensional variant of what we had before. So there also exists other type of generalizations to higher dimensions, but it's really another construction. So this is from this point of view. Okay. Okay, so this is for this, for the isometries, but what we did before was looking at discrete subgroups. So if we again do this, this is what we will call this higher modular, but we need to be a bit careful. And that's something I should a bit emphasize, is that the problem with this type of matrices is that what is written here, this gamma NR, except for the small values, these are simply groups of invertible elements. These are no longer rings. So it's no longer simply a matrix ring over some ring. So it's a little bit more annoying, but okay. So the integral part is defined as following. We simply consider those with integral coefficients, let's say. And the group SL plus gamma and Z. These type of groups are called the higher modular groups. So why this name? The name simply comes from the fact of when we look at the smaller examples. So if I would look at n equal to one, then the group that we simply get is SL2 over Z. So the modular group of before, let's say, and that's already why higher modular groups. For n equal to 2, we get the 2x2 matrices of the over the Gaussian integers. And in the case of n equal to 4, one can prove that actually what we get I will come back to this later on, but this will actually be a subgroup of index 4 into SL2 over the Lipschitz quaternions.
May I ask why you jumped from 2 to 4 and missed 3?
Yes, that's a good question. So n equal to 3 has a concrete description, but it doesn't, for me, it doesn't resemble an object which I'm used to in nature, let's say. So it is an object somehow in between the Gaussian integers and the classical Lipschitz quaternions, but it's an object that I don't recognize simply like from other situations. But one can find another type of description, a concrete presentation, but I have no. It's simply, I don't like the other description. Also.
But group theory, from the point of view of group theory, it might be even better than others. I mean, as good as the other one.
Yes, that is fully true. I agree. But for our applications afterwards, we actually really are interested in this n equal to 4 case, especially And this also probably is one of the reasons that I'm focusing on N equal to 4 and making this jump. Okay. But so I have no good reason for making the jump.
Okay.
To be honest. Okay. Okay. So these are really generalizations somehow of not all Bianchi groups or all Kleinian groups or all Fuchsian groups. These are really more kind of generalizations of the modular group and certain type of variant. But these are still groups of some geometric nature. So these are still the isometric, the orientation preserving isometries of a hyperbolic space. And what I want to consider is actually now will not be some geometric object, but object of an algebraic nature. And these are certain subgroups that we define, which are called the elementary subgroups. Okay, the elementary subgroup. So simply to put for 1 second a step back. So if again I consider a general commutative ring, and if I would look at the n by n invertible matrices of this ring, okay, I have certain type of elements in it that we all know very well since our first class linear algebra classes. We have these elementary matrices. So this is a have ones on the diagonal. And the element R on the spot EG. And then we have the diagonal matrices, which I denote by DNR. So these are the diagonal. And we are used from quite early on, we are used that if R is a nice ring, that after elementary operations, we can reduce actually any matrix to a diagonal matrix. Or in other words, we are used that if R is nice, that actual GLN is generated really by everything which is here. So what do I mean by nice here? This is a bit complicated to tell and take a little bit more of time, but the way one should define or look at nice is actually using algebraic K theory. And the notion of bus introduced in the 60s, which he called the stable range of the ring. And if this stable range is in a good proportion, let's say, with the size of the matrices, then we have this equality. So what is an example, let's say, where everything works, is that if R would say, would be, again, for example, the ring of integers in a number field, or more generally, if R would be an Z order in a finite dimensional division algebra over Q, so for example, ring of integers, as I said, in a number field, then these rings are nice from the moment on that you're working with at least 3x3 matrices. So there already in this type of very classical cases, we see that there is a very special role played by 2x2 matrices. And in general, in the 2x2 cases, the situation is indeed much more complicated. And actually one should already take other type of invariants in account and not only the stable range. One should also take into account some arithmetic property from the center of the division algebra. The arithmetic property I am speaking about is the S rank, let's say, of the group SL2D. But I will not go into detail for the moment, because I will speak about another very concrete algebraic aspect of it, which is something which PM Kohn looked at in the 60s already. Kohn's point of view. So what he defined is, okay, so he called in the 2x2 cases, so now we are only, so now we really, due to this, we only look at 2x2 matrices. And there our elementary matrices look very nicely, simply as this. And the matrix, the part generated by these elementary matrices, I will denote by E2. And Kohn defined the ring to be a GA2 ring if we have equality at that spot. And so, as I said, the typical example is if R is an Euclidean ring, because then we can basically do again this Gauss reduction, so it is using the Euclidean algorithm. But there is also other examples, but they are quite scarce. For example, one can prove actually that Z added with the square root of -3 is also a G2 ring, but it's not Euclidean. Another example which is not Euclidean and a G2 ring is the something we proved in our paper, are again the Lipschitz quaternions, but they are not Euclidean. So these are all G2 rings. And what is of importance in the work of Kohn is not simply introducing, of course, his definition, is but the way he was dealing with elementary matrices. He had this very big insight that actually that the elementary matrices were not the right type of thing to look at. It was better to look at another type of generating set, namely the following. Simply look at the following matrices. So they are simply another set of generators, and they behave much more nicely if you want to do computations. So, for example, they will satisfy what he called a certain set of universal relations. And somehow his point of view was that the best way to show that a ring has this G2 property is showing that all the relations must come from these universal relations. This theory, that's something that we weakened a little bit, so we don't, for getting this one, doesn't need to have truly that all relations come from the universal ones, but still this, somehow he had the right philosophy of working with these generators and looking at this type of relations. And so why I'm mentioning this is we want also to look at this type of object, but inside this higher modular groups. So what did we define? We define the group E2 gamma NZ. So which again, as I said, this is not a ring, so we cannot simply write down directly take the definition, but still the same spirit works. So we look at all these matrices and we actually can check that these matrices live inside the SL plus gamma and Z. So this lives in this higher modular group. And this is what we call the elementary part of the SL plus gamma and Z. So maybe I should already say that one can prove that if we would look at the lower dimensional cases, so n smaller or equal to 4, then actually we have that this E2 is really the full group. So all matrices, all Wallen matrices come really from these elementary ones. However, we didn't pursue to check how big is a subgroup generated by these elementary matrices for n greater than 4. So that's a question that I will then simply ask. So to what is equal to this index? So actually, one could expect that this index will actually in general be infinite. So because if you simply look at the methods, we actually notice that somehow these Wallen matrices, and in general also the SL version, really behave very strongly like 2x2 matrices over a ring of integers in a quadratic imaginary field extension. And if we again look at this setting of before, so this was this setting of this ring of integers. There it is known that the index is infinite of the elementary matrices in general. And this will actually be infinite exactly when the ring is not Euclidean. When it is not Euclidean, and this is known to be the, when ring of integers are Euclidean, this is, the parameters are known, these are simply the following numbers. So since that these groups will really behave like this 2x2 matrix of a ring of integers, one could expect that the answer here is also infinite. And so Thiessen in particular says that this E2 are really different type of groups in that they are much smaller and they are actually really algebraic objects and they are no longer geometric objects. Okay, but nevertheless, actually they are somehow nice behaved objects that for the purpose of representation theory are quite more of interest. Okay, so for the last 6 minutes, I will speak about amalgamated decompositions of this groups. So what did we do in our joint work? So without going into details, we've basically generalized the methods of Kohn really to this setting of higher modular groups. And we using, and in that way, we actually found an algorithm which gives a very nice final presentation of these elementary groups. And I should say what I mean by very nice. Of E to Z is that it is not simply a finite generating set, a finite presentation. It is a finite presentation where you can read off quite a lot of things. So using this finite presentation, one can quite quickly, one needs still to work a little bit, but can quite fastly see an amalgamate and decomposition for these groups. And out of this, we saw that actually all these elementary parts of the higher modular groups are nested into each other in a very clear way. So the E2 part, the elementary part of the nth higher modular group, is an amalgamate and decomposition of two subgroups with amalgamating subgroup, the elementary of one dimension lower.
I can see very well. With A and B what? Explicit.
Some explicit subgroups.
Ah, nice.
So it, they are really given by presentation, let's say, also in the paper, but for now it writing down would be a bit more time consuming. But so they are nested into each other. Okay, so maybe I should say several things about this. So as I said, the element, one could ask as a question, what about the full SLs? So we were really interested in the elementary subgroups, but what about the full SLs? So does this phenomena also happens? The answer will be, the methods will be for sure a little bit different. So as I tried to explain earlier on, these are really algebraic objects and our methods are also very algebraic. These are more geometric objects. So if this would also kind of happen for these groups, which I believe actually will be the case, then probably geometrically, these phenomena should say that, okay, these are still certain arithmetic subgroups of some algebraic U groups. Hence, there is some orbifold space connected to it. And then probably the fact that it is an amalgamated decomposition above this would mean that the SL plus over one dimension lower corresponds to some embedded, totally geodesic orbifold, which would then be separated. So that's this type of very geometric models, and we didn't try to follow this because, again, we were really interested by the elementary part. But if the indexes are infinite anyway, so if we have a decomposition for this, it doesn't imply directly a decomposition for this. So these are two different parts. Okay, so about this. I will only take 2 other minutes to say one thing about the proof, is that the proof is really not so much about this group. This proof really works much more generally for the E2, also over E2 over, let's say, orders in division algebras, but not any type of orders, but orders with a finite unit group. So this type of orders, the existence is a very big restriction on the division algebra, and actually this can only happen for imaginary quadratic extension and certain type of quaternion, totally definite quaternion algebras. But these are exactly the cases where the general theory doesn't work very well. With the general theory, I mean, so this K theory, but also the answers to the stable concurrence problem are not as nice. So our proof also works in this setting. And for every of these orders, we really get a finite presentation. But if these orders have a basis consisting of invertible elements, and this is a very special property, but these groups have somehow this. But again, these are not rings, so one needs to be careful at every stage. But due to the fact that they have a basis of units, we have really a very clear presentation. And with this method, we actually also got the following nice other consequence, which is that if I take E2O So if I, if I take an order in a quadratic imaginary extension, then the E2 of this has an amalgamated decomposition as following. So B2 is a Borel subgroup. So it has a decomposition of this form. So they all come somehow from their Borel subgroup and elementary matrix of the integers. And what I like a lot with this decomposition is that it also actually complements a decomposition which was already existing for the SL2. So despite them having in general infinite index, this decomposition really gives, there was already a result known of Roman, and fine. Which said that the SL2 of the ring of integers in a quadratic field extension actually was of the form an amalgamated decomposition of two groups, but with one of the parts being the elementary subgroup, and somehow our decomposition gives a further decomposition of this elementary subgroup. So it also complements even those which are purely only interested in the SL2 subgroup. But yeah, so our algorithm really works in a much more general way, but above all works for this. And in the rest of our paper and work, we actually use all this knowledge about elementary matrices and special linear groups to understand more generally semi-simple rational algebras, and in particular understanding rational group algebra and integral group ring inside. But since my time is over, I will done. Stop here. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Well, thanks, the speaker, for his nice talk. Very gentle. And I open question session. Anybody wants to ask question?
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Sure.
Hi, Geoffrey. I have a quick question. Are you aware of other decompositions as amalgams for other elementary groups, like the one that you gave in the end?
So you mean that whether if so you mean that. So except very precise small examples, where actually the elementary matrix. So I was mainly aware of examples of decompositions for the SL2, mm-hmm. And so in small cases where the E2 actually equals SL2, then of course we also had for the E2. But for the rest, I was not that much aware of the E2 decompositions.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So yeah. So somehow I would actually also be interested to see what happens for E2 over the totally definite quaternion algebras, which were also part of our interest. But I think now at one paper, so Kahn wrote this paper with all these methods for understanding the elementary matrices of 2x2 elementary matrices. And there is one other paper which, but I forgot the author. I once saw a paper which actually somehow got lost over the history. And where he actually already also investigates amalgamated decompositions for E2 for more general rings. And where somehow his point is that what is important for getting an amalgam decomposition is that the ring doesn't have a basis consisting of invertible elements. And he uses this language of Kahn, says if the ring has only universal relations and has a basis consisting of units, then he always also can make amalgamated decompositions. The problem is that these conditions of that all relations come from the universal ones in the sense of con was a bit too strong. But this can be a little bit softener, and then this same spirit we used to also find sometimes more of amalgamated decompositions. That's for the rest.
Right, thanks.
Yeah, any other questions? Well, I have a question. These volume groups, they somehow have a sort of a version of spinner group, all right?
Yes, also yes.
And I know there is some paper, old paper of Lyubotsky, where he put a similar type of produced similar type of amalgamation, and he used similar notation at least, right? Gamma over gamma n minus one, where gamma n minus one is some congruent subgroup of something, right? Do you know the paper?
So there is one paper. So I don't know if it is that paper, but I know there is one paper, I think, from 96.
It should be something like that. Yeah.
So not that long paper where he actually investigates. Hyperbolic manifolds.
Where
he also investigates H and N extension amalgamate and decompositions. And as an application, he considers actually these Bianchi groups, where he then actually finds very explicit decompositions for the SL2, and also proves that the first Betti number is non-trivial for.
Yeah, but I mean, why your decompositions in his decomposition are not the same? What is the difference actually?
So actually, we looked into his methods of that paper, and that's also what I wanted to. That's what I was referring actually to somehow. When I was speaking about this SL plus, so for his methods really apply to this SL plus groups probably. One it's still to do a bit of geometry, but probably it does apply. However, it will be the SL plus, it will not be the elementary matrices, which is of infinite index. And a priori, I don't see a geometric context for this elementary matrix. This really seems to be algebraic objects. But again, maybe they are finite index, but I would be surprised to in general. So for the higher ends. And then it is not that we can simply use this method. For the SL plus, probably one we can. And actually we use his methods to prove from that paper, to prove that they always, all the SL plus here, gamma n, have a subgroup of finite index, which have infinite abelization. So this we worked. And once we wanted to continue a little bit more with his methods to really write down amalgamated decomposition, but at the end we didn't, because we didn't need it, because we already had this very concrete one from the elementary matrices, which anyway correspond to the full SL in the small dimensions.
Yeah, and just reinforcing a bit the question, I mean, your decomposition, it resembles some kind of hierarchy, because you split higher over lower, actually, dimensional group, right? And again, it seems to me, I saw something like in Bergeron paper, I think something, that these groups are likely to be virtually special. In virtual special groups in the Danny Weiss sense. Virtual special groups, they are sort of, it is difficult to define. It is about cobulation and really geometry. But they embed, for example, virtually embed in right art and angle groups, right?
Okay.
And this produce similar hierarchy like amalgamation and Asian extension over subgroups of finite index. So I mean, you see, in that method direction, it is all virtually, means up to finite index.
Yes.
All right. And it also gives hierarchy, right? And hierarchy comes back then to free group and trivial group, right? And I wonder whether your amalgamation and that amalgamations, or your hierarchy and that hierarchy has something in common or similar flavor or similar nature?
It is a good question. I don't know. So if it is fully the same. I think that one of the reasons we, for the SL plus gamma N, we didn't went further in the methods of Lyubotsky was somehow, because we had the impression that it wouldn't be that nice. It should be that it would indeed again give this hierarchy probably, but somehow the A and B would be maybe less explicit, and we wanted it to be more explicit.
No, there it is also not explicit at all. But in fact, they don't talk about spinor group, but about orthogonal group, which is when you go to arithmeticity, it's commensurable, right?
Yes. Yes.
All right, and therefore it is. But since they do everything virtually, it doesn't matter. All right, and then S or something like this orthogonal group, they when they take arithmetic subgroup, they produce this they prove that it's virtually special, and therefore exists a hierarchy. And that's how it goes.
Yeah. Okay. It is anyway interesting. So maybe we should actually once work it out and see if it gives the same amalgamated decomposition.
Or maybe some decomposition in the cases you don't know. I don't know as well.
Yes, that it's an interesting question. Thank you.
Any more questions or comments? Well, if not, let's speak. Thanks, speaker again. Thank you.